So we have three talks now, of a half an hour each. The first is by Professor Wendy Cho, who's a political science and also a professor in statistics and Asian American studies. Professor Cho is a native of San Francisco. She went to UC Berkeley undergraduate and got in the field of applied mathematics and computer science and political science. She, as an interdisciplinary person, started in law school but graduated in political science and statistics at UC Berkeley. And she, in 1997, she came to University of Illinois, and she's been associated with lots of different units, including NCSA and the CSE program. And so I guess her talk is given here. You'll hear about a computational approach to redistricting reform.
Thank you. So this is my project, an extreme scale computational approach to redistricting optimization. So this brings together basically everything I've always been interested in. I've actually worked on this problem as my senior honors thesis when I was an undergraduate, but that was nearly 30 years ago, and computing has advanced tremendously since then, and so the project has gotten so much better. So let me begin by talking about how I got into political science. So political science for me has always been really interesting because I've always been fascinated with this concept of power. How do people obtain power? And that's what we study in political science, power. So in human societies, how do people retain power? How do people achieve power? How do we legitimize power in societies? How do humans organize themselves into these types of governing structures? So one of the things that's interesting to me about that is, first of all, power is just interesting. But in the United States, we have governing institutions. And in other countries, they have different governing institutions. So I think about maybe 5 years ago, I showed my kids this documentary about North Korea, and they were so fascinated by that. They're like, how did that happen? Like, how is this governing society legitimate? How do these people, you know, live in this society with that kind of a ruler? And, you know, they're children, so we had to talk about it. And one of the things that we talked about was a lot of it is the power of information, right? They have certain kinds of information, you have other kinds of information. And that is part of what legitimizes power in governing institutions. And I said, you know, this happens in the United States too. We have certain kinds of power, we have certain kinds of information, and that's just, you know, part of life. So this is partly inspired by that idea. So redistricting has always been a fascination of mine because it determines power. So let me talk about that real quick. So redistricting is the process of putting people, areas into districts and then electing representatives. So map number one over there is this hypothetical state that's, you know, some rectangle. And they've got Republicans and Democrats in it, half Republican and half Democrat. So once you redistrict and you draw these people into districts, map two is one way to redistrict, where in that you've got this kind of, reverse seven over there that's got three Republicans in it, or, you know, three areas that are Republican dominated, and then three areas that are democratically dominated. So if you had that map too, if you redrew the people that way, you almost certainly would elect three quarters Democrats and one quarter Republican, even though it's half and half the state. So if you move to map three, all we're doing here is changing the district lines, and here we've got three Republican districts and one Democratic district. Same state, same people, all we're doing is manipulating the lines, and we can turn it from dominated by Democrats to dominated by Republicans to map four, which is just drawn a different way, just straight down. You've got half Republican and half Democrats. So we haven't moved anybody around, but we've, you know, changed the way the state is governed. And so in that way, redistricting basically determines power. Once you have the districts drawn, you don't actually have all that much leeway in who is going to get elected, or at least in which power, in which party will be in power. So we call this gerrymandering generally, and we try to regulate it because we think it's bad, but it proceeds largely unimpeded, even though we have all these legal constraints in place. We have restraints on population, on contiguity, on other traits like that. So let me talk through a couple districts here. So this is the 12th district in North Carolina. It is 160 miles long. It travels down Interstate 85. It goes from Durham to Charlotte through Greensboro and Winston-Salem, for those of you who know the state. And what it's doing there is it had some people it wanted in the district, and then it didn't want the other people around it, so it traveled down the highway where nobody lives, and then once it got to another place where it wanted some people, it branched out, grabbed some people, got back on the highway, went down, grabbed some more people, went down, until they had enough people of the kinds of people they wanted, and then we're done. So that's 160 miles long. This is Louisiana's 4th district. It literally looks like the state of Louisiana. It's got every part of it. It's got the top, it's got the right, it's got the bottom. It actually looks like Louisiana. Here in the state of Illinois, we do it too. We call this one the Earmuff District. Same thing. They wanted the population up there at the top right, and then in the lower right, and in between, they just had to get to that other population without getting the people in the middle. So it took its way down over to I-294, which is over there on the left, and on the way, it went through some forest preserves, some cemeteries, came back around, found the rest of the people they wanted, drew their district. So that's the Earmuff District. This one is my personal favorite of all the districts because it looks like a horse with a man falling off, or perhaps a cow falling off a horse. So these are actual districts. If I asked you to draw a district that you thought was really ugly, you couldn't draw something this good. This is the truth is better than fiction kind of a thing that goes on in life. It's an actual district. Journalists like it so much, we like to give them names. That one we call the Hanging Claw, the North Carolina's 4th. This one we call the Pinwheel of Death, Maryland's 3rd. So there's a lot of interesting things going on in redistricting. And these, again, actual districts, past our legal constraints for how districts are drawn and what we can do with redistricting. So US elections are largely non-competitive. I don't know how many people know that in the United States, but this is the US House re-election rates for the last several decades. It's really high. I mean, we keep putting these guys back in office. Can we help it? I'm not sure we can help it because, you know, the way the districts are drawn, they're largely safe seats. Do we like these guys in Congress? We do not. We don't like them, but we keep putting them back in office over and over and over again. So this is a really interesting phenomenon about American politics, that we have this type of power structure, this way of doing redistricting, this way of not liking our congressmen, but putting them back in office over and over again. So what are the societal consequences of gerrymandering? I don't actually know, because this is the way we do it. This is the way we've been doing it. We don't do it a different way, so we don't have a counterfactual to compare it against. What's the impact of that on democracy? I also don't know the answer to that question, because this is the only way we've been doing it. But we recognize these as important questions that we'd like to analyze in some way, perhaps change. I'm not sure, actually, what would happen if we actually changed this way of governing in the United States. because this process is not very open, redistricting. So usually what happens is in two-thirds of the state legislature draws the districts, and whoever's in power in the state legislature, they're basically in charge, right? They pass it as a regular law. You never see this. They you know, write it up as a law. These are the districts. They take a vote. The vote passes. Those are the districts for 10 years. It's supposed to be an open process, so I don't know how many of you know this, but in the state of Illinois, there is a room, but you don't know where the room is, but there is a room that is open to the entire public. Anyone can come to the room. Anyone can go to the room where all the data is, and you may sit there and draw districts as you wish and submit them to the legislature. There's a room. You can do this. Does anyone do this? Not too many people do this, nor know about the room, but there is a room. And supposedly, it's supposed to be an open process, but it really is not an open process. So what do we want to do? So this project is about changing how redistricting is done, because we've reached a stage now where computing power is much more powerful. I told you I worked on this problem like 30 years ago as an undergraduate. I didn't get very far. I just couldn't get the computer to do what I wanted it to do. But computing power has increased tremendously, so I want to talk a little bit about what we've been doing with this. So the process of creating districts, so of partitioning some set of units into K parts, non-empty parts, the number of ways of doing that is a Stirling number of the second kind. So I put up some Stirling numbers of the second kind here. So 55 on the right and 6 would be like, there are 55 counties in the state of West Virginia, and there's 6 congressional districts. If you were to divide 55 counties and 6 congressional districts, the number of ways of doing that is 8.7 times 10 to the 39. That's a really big number. To give you some perspective, there have been fewer than 10 to the 18th seconds since the universe began. That's a bigger number than 10 to the 18th, a lot bigger. And that is if you wanted to partition counties. If you wanted to look at all the possibilities, that's partitioning counties into districts. We never partition counties into districts. Those are much too big. Instead, what we work with is, this is the state of Minnesota, which has 87 counties, 1,337 census tracts, more than 250,000 census blocks, and 8 congressional districts. So you can imagine how much bigger of a problem this is. And if you just look at it, I put up the census blocks there. Those are those little black lines. You can't really even see them because there's so many of them. But the idea is, in every one of those little census blocks, we have all this information about who lives there, how they voted, how many Republicans, how many Democrats, who voted in the last election, how many women, how many this, how many that. In every one of those little things, we have all this information, and we just manipulate those into districts, which is how we get such incredibly refined districts. We have so much information. But this problem, the actual problem where you take 250,000 census blocks and put them into 8 congressional districts, is so much larger than that last one I showed you with the West Virginia counties. So what is our approach to doing this? We want to develop a computational tool for redistricting analysis, and the idea is, if there actually were a tool that people could use, the process would actually be much more open. And just opening up the process to different people changes the process considerably. Because right now it's just done behind closed doors. I mean, it's supposed to be open, but it's really not open. People don't actually have the data. People don't have the power or the tools to analyze the data. And we've now gone to a point where that's actually almost the possibility. Not quite, but almost a possibility. And if we could actually create a tool where people could use it, and they could actually synthesize and kind of understand the massive amounts of information that are there and the way that they can be put together, we would make the process imminently more transparent, you know, for everyone. And the legislature could use it too, because right now they just sit there and they kind of draw, but it's not, they don't analyze possibilities the way that you could be able to. So, this is a project that is for which we have a grant on Blue Waters, and we've been using Exceed. So So let me explain the basic project to you. So this is counties in Minnesota, because if I showed you the smaller units, you couldn't see anything. So I show you the bigger units. But this is the state of Minnesota, 87 counties. And we also did the initial debugging on counties, because again, you can't see the smaller units. So we developed a genetic algorithm. This is the chromosome. The chromosome just has a, every unit goes in a district. The district is what's in the chromosome. You develop the contiguity graph. So this is the adjacency matrix. Blue is they share a border. Red is they share a point. I guess that's not important. But we basically generate random districts that satisfy the legal constraints. So here it's just building a district. And then we create what is a legal district. So in the process, we have all these legal constraints that either the Supreme Court has put onto a district or are just legal constraints by the legislature or idiosyncratic to the state or whatever. These are all legal districts drawn by a computer with no interest in doing anything. It just happens to be legal district with some objective. So the genetic algorithm does it does the standard mutation crossover replacement, and I'll just explain those briefly. So the idea is you draw a legal district and then you start moving around that district to make it better under some set of constraints. So the one we've been mostly playing with is competitiveness. We've been trying to find the districts that are the most competitive, districts that are possible within the state. And so here, the mutation basically just takes units on the border and starts swapping them around, looking for other legal districts that satisfy some nice constraint like being competitive, which the legislature doesn't usually want to do, but we like that. So this is the crossover operation. So crossover in a genetic algorithm, usually what it does is it takes two solutions and it mates them looking for a better solution. So the idea behind a genetic algorithm is every generation where you're looking for a new solution that gets better and better. It's like an evolving population. And then hopefully it evolves into an optimal population. So this is the crossover where it takes two solutions and it mates them. So here are two solutions that we found. And then what happens is you overlap the solutions. You basically lie one on top of the other and then you repair it into a legal solution. So that's what's going on there. That gives you big movements between legal maps. And then that's the crossover. And then we replace, which, is easy and hard to understand. In the process, we do all sorts of landscape analysis because this landscape is so large, the number of districts that are actually possible to draw is so big. We're trying to figure out how we can ensure that we actually move around the solution space in some nice way. So let me talk a little bit about what we're doing there. So one of the things we're working on blue waters, and we played around with it on Exceed with 16,384 cores. So moving up to blue waters with its 724,480 cores is a different animal. It works pretty well on tens of thousands of cores, and we're having a little bit of trouble moving up to hundreds of thousands of cores. But so part of the project really is just working with this distributed algorithm, how to figure out, if you have one computer working on it, how do you get them, a lot of computers to work on it in parallel and to make that more efficient and look at more solutions and just get through that solution space the way you want to. We tested a little bit. So one of the things that, one of the problems with moving up to a lot of cores is that the different computing cores will exchange information with each other. And when they exchange information with each other, you have to figure out how to do that in an efficient way. So the idea is that everybody can search for maps. All 724,000 processors can search for maps, and then at some point they will exchange information and then move around the solution space some more based on that. the way parallel processing works when you don't have very many processors is everybody kind of works on their own and they all stop and then they exchange information and then they all go again. When you have 724,000 cores, that's really inefficient to wait for everybody to stop and then everybody to exchange. So we developed this asynchronous migration strategy where people can migrate at not at the same time, basically, which makes it a lot more efficient because everybody's working most of the time and working in an efficient way. So we tested this on, these are numbers off of Exceed, and what you're supposed to be looking at here is as the number of processors increases from 0 to 16,000 processors on Exceed, the processing time goes is much faster. What you can get through it goes much faster. So that's strong scaling, this is weak scaling, same thing, right? It's getting a lot better if you don't use a synchronous strategy, which I think is obvious, but tuning the asynchronous strategy is actually a little bit difficult. So that same thing, the communication costs we've reduced considerably with this, with this idea. And there are several other things that we're working on to try to get it to look through the solution space more efficiently. But one of the things I like about this project is it brings so much together of all the things I've ever worked on in my entire life. It's an important substantive area. I've always been fascinated with redistricting. But what it also does is it produces this really large optimization instance for a supercomputer. And I'm really interested in that aspect of it as well. And they work really nicely together because there actually aren't, it's actually not that easy to think of such large optimization instances that would run, you would need actually a supercomputer and you actually learn how to study other problems, other optimization problems on a supercomputer. Because the things that we're working on as far as, you know, just moving through the solution space, being more efficient, that works for any type of optimization problem. It's not just, not just this one. So the two problems work really nicely together. You're working on something that's interesting, substantively important, and it gives you insight into other problems that maybe other people would be interested in working on that would also run on large supercomputers. So they have a nice mutualistic relationship there. And this, I think, is coming back to the idea of information. The power of information, I think, is fascinating, because what's happened in the last, decade is we've seen the power of information transform so much of society, right? Once we get information out there, people are more efficient, or you can do more things, or you can, and we haven't seen this a lot in the social sciences, but we see it a lot in other things, like GPS or just connecting people, social media. It changes society and how we think of society. And I think that also, the time has come for us to, figure out how to use that kind of thing to improve society, how to improve how we govern, how to improve how we interact with each other as a society. And I think this, if we could do this, it would really transform the way redistricting is done, how we govern, how we create districts. It would transform the way legislatures draw this. And I've been working on some kind of side, not the algorithms itself, but using this algorithm to connect it to what the Supreme Court has been saying about how we should redistrict and what goes into our rights is our right to vote. So those actually dovetail really nicely, because the Supreme Court's been talking about ideas that are actually really nicely dovetailing into computational thinking. They just don't know that, but it does. So the ability to do this, I think, will transform redistricting. And I'm not sure if it will do that in a good way. This is something I struggle with a little bit, because you put that out there, and sometimes when you disrupt things, it's bad, actually. So I don't know if it's good or bad, but I think that the time has come and that this is definitely where we're going and where we will end up going. But the ability to bring in, I think, computational thinking and statistical modeling into social science, I think will transform social science as well. So that's the impetus behind this project. that's it.
Well, thank you. We have time for some questions. Yeah?
Yeah, you can test it against random, except random's usually not interesting to anyone, right? Because either they're not legal or it's just not interesting, right? So one of the papers we've been working on is trying to understand the existing plan, because right now what they do is, I said, they pass a plan as a law, and then that's the plan. So one of the problems with the when it goes up to the Supreme Court is the Supreme Court doesn't know if that is a good plan or a bad plan, because they're only presented with one plan. Right, and then they're supposed to say this violates your right to vote in some way. It creates voter dilution, creates whatever. The Supreme Court is unable to analyze that one thing in isolation. And so one of the things that we've been working on is saying, okay, if you only have that one plan, it's not possible to understand it. You got to create the context around it. And one of the ways to create the context is to set a computer off. And so we generated basically, you know, 500,000 plans that are good. And say, you know, is this an outlier? Like, is the one you drew, is it way off on what could be done and what could be done well? And if it is, then maybe we should rethink that. And if it's not, then you just say, well, it's not that bad, right? But you don't understand if it's good or bad unless you know what's possible. And so we've been using it partly as a what's possible kind of tool. No, so everybody has their own notion. So everybody wants to optimize something different, but that's no problem. We can optimize anything. I mean, it's a broad framework, right? Whatever you want to do, you can say, let's do that, and we just kind of set the parameters in a different way. And if someone wants to set them differently, we create different things. And so part of it is then humans are supposed to take that back and analyze it and say, this is what we have. So the computer is not going to say this is good or bad. The computer does what you want and you take it back.
Yeah, it would be, I mean, I think that's a really interesting question that, I mean, it looks like the founders of the Constitution, you know, Jefferson and Adams, and these people, the writers, were kind of into algorithms, except they didn't have data or computers. And it seems like, you know, they did have, you know, one man, one vote at the time, or except for slaves, and the I think what they would have come up with is just something based on geometry and not based on all these other things. I mean, you might say African Americans or other groups should be represented in a certain way, but once you start doing that, seems like a really long, slippery slope. But maybe you should just do it based on geometry, like most compact districts. I mean, they've always accepted the idea of things being contiguous, so why not just go down that route of making things as compact as possible?
So that is one of the things we can do, is integrate compactness. So again, it's one of these things where you want compactness, you want contiguity, you want population, you know, lack of deviation, you want competitiveness. You can weight those in different ways and see what comes out, right? You say, I want mostly compact.
But from a statistical mechanics point of view, there's some, you know, get in the cross-disciplinary part, there are some criteria which are frustrated and others that are non-frustrated computationally.
Yeah.
So maybe you want a non-frustrated a criteria that is, it has, you know, an easy solution. That's one idea. Although with a computer, I suppose it doesn't matter. You can work with these complicated things that lead to very, you know, glassy-like problems.
Yeah. I mean, it really depends on what the humans want, right?
Yeah. Any more questions? Yeah.
Yeah, California has an independent commission. I think by and large, people have been unhappy with the bipartisan commissions, because one, they're not really bipartisan. Usually it's half Democrats, half Republicans, and they have to come up with something. So I think it's never uninterested parties or disinterested parties. And this takes a lot of the interest just kind of out of it, right? And they also don't have the ability to see a lot of different possibilities.
It's not obvious, because then they would start arguing about the criteria, because they would run a bunch of solutions with different parameters, and they'd say, well, I want this set of parameters, right?
Yeah.
It just moves it to a different level.
I think it's similar. If you had the information, people have less of an ability to argue, because a commission is the same thing. They come up with a thing, right? That's the thing. It's like, I don't understand that thing. Is that thing good? Is that thing bad? What else was possible? What did you throw out? And then, you know, if you had the ability to contextualize, then you could understand that.
Hi. So my question is, how healthy it's for the democracy that you are addressing the other aspect of it, that there are some counties which have always voted a particular way. So dividing the district in that way is beneficial, so you can kind of predict the outcome. But it's also kind of also tells that there are some counties which are irrespective of what the, if a person is serving well or not, they are always voting either red or blue. So how healthy it is in a democracy that people are not changing their leanings. So it's very important in a democracy, even for people to be kind of bipartisan, that, oh, if this particular person doesn't perform well, then you give a chance to other party. But it's kind of very concerning to me that you don't see that shift happening.
Yeah, I think you're talking about competitive districts, right? So if you put basically a closer number of Republicans and Democrats in a district, and the candidate has to appeal to, you know, some set of people to switch over, right? So if you have more competitive districts, it changes the face of campaigning and who gets in office and who, you know, doesn't care at all and says, I'm going to be in office anyway. It doesn't matter if I go out there or not. You know, I have so many Republicans, I'm going to be reelected. It changes that dynamic.
I think my question is even more basic than that there are some people who are not willing to change their leaning, irrespective of, so I'm basically, my question is even more, I think, goes more deep that why are people not kind of changing their leanings towards a particular party or asset?
Well, that maybe is outside of the scope, I guess. But
yeah, that's a kind of a deep psychological.
We have to move on here, actually, so we don't get too far behind. Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Professor Charles Schroeder from the Chemical and Bioengineering Department, who's one of our Beckman Fellows for this year, as was the previous speaker. Professor Schroeder got his BS at Carnegie Mellon and a PhD at Stanford, did a postdoc at Harvard and Berkeley, and has been here for 5 years or so, I guess, and
7 years,
so lots of awards at the U of I, and including a career award and so forth. Are you on here?
I need to get.
Anyway, he's going to talk about new frontiers in single polymer dynamics.
Well, thank you for the introduction. So this morning, it's my pleasure to tell you about some of the work we've been doing in my group over the last few years. And so this involves new frontiers in single polymer dynamics. And in particular, I'm going to tell you about some work that we've been doing looking at polymers with nonlinear topologies. So-called branch polymer chains and chains with sort of these nonlinear architectures or shapes. So let me begin with an outline or an overview of my research program. So in my group, we study the dynamics of single polymers and soft materials, oftentimes using a molecular scale approach. And so basically what this means is that we use single molecule measurements using fluorescence microscopy or some sort of optical imaging techniques to study the dynamics of single chains right down to the molecular level. And today I'm going to give you at least one example of a problem that we've been studying recently, so the so-called branch polymer chain, so single molecule studies of branch polymers, where we've extended the field of single polymer imaging to these chains with nonlinear topologies. And so we're asking questions about, you know, the role of branching, and so when you have a long linear backbone or you have chains, side branches emanating from that, how does that actually change the movement and dynamics of these polymers at the molecular scale? And I'll tell you one story as we get to the end about how we're directly looking at the relaxation of these chains from high stretch using single molecule studies, and how in particular topology or the shape, the location of branch points and the number of branch points and their molecular weight and their size actually determines the dynamics directly. So I don't have time to tell you a completely different story, although something that we've been interested in recently, and something also that was sort of enabled by the Center Advanced Study Fellowship last semester, is our work in moving into more concentrated solutions. So-called polymer dynamics in these semi-dilute or concentrated solutions, where now you have, we're basically looking at a single polymer, but in the context of, you know, concentrated environment. So what are the effects of intermolecular interactions, and what sort of conformations do these chains take and flow? And how does the situation change when you have this entangled environment, essentially? So as you could kind of tell from the last slide, my lab is very much interested in achieving a fundamental understanding of soft materials dynamics, oftentimes polymer dynamics, using a single molecule approach. So our work is very fundamental. I guess to some degree we have an eye towards applications, but in many cases we're just asking fundamental questions about materials dynamics. So for example, how do these soft materials flow into form? And kind of our favorite one are our long polymer chains, flexible or semi-flexible polymer chains. And kind of a major question that overarches a lot of our research is how does, you know, molecular motion, so motion right down at the molecular scale, how does that give rise to emergent or bulk scale properties of materials? So how can we understand, you know, these bulk or macroscopic materials like, you know, bulk dynamics or bulk stress or, you know, viscoelasticity, so the fact that a material can have both solid-like and liquid-like properties, how can we understand all these properties in the context of molecular scale interactions? So chain chemistry, for example, or the shape of the molecules, the architecture, which is going to play a role today in our discussions, more specific, you know, molecular scale interactions between monomers. You know, and in some cases, in the context of I guess, an engineering department, we are thinking about optimizing processing or designing new processing conditions to sort of understand these. So, you know, I'm going to talk a lot about basically molecular single molecule dynamics, and as a tool, as you know, to understand the motions of these chains. It turns out that there's a rich history, you know, in the field for using bulk level techniques to study materials properties. And so, you know, in the past we've learned a tremendous amount of information from these so-called, you know, bulk scale methods like birefringence or light scattering or X-ray, you know, techniques, neutron scattering, those types of approaches. You know, but in those situations, you're basically just getting an average sort of sense of what's going on in the material. So you can kind of probe microstructure somewhat locally, but you get an average sense of what's going on in a material. And that's been very useful. And you know, even, so aside from optical techniques, even sort of mechanical rheometry methods have played a key role in this area as well, and they've kind of been imported to microfluidic devices recently. You know, so one of the questions you might be thinking, okay, well, why do we even need, you know, these techniques to begin with? If we have this really nice, you know, host of methods, bulk scale methods, you could walk over to MRL, or you can go up to argon and do light scattering methods, you know, why are we going to mess around with doing microscopy and single polymer dynamics? And so, well, if you can actually, you know, look at dynamics of single polymer chains, you have some advantages. So I'm going to show you here basically two movies that are characteristic of what we see when we do our experiments. And so these are fluorescently labeled pieces of double-stranded DNA. So in many cases, and I'll explain this in a few more slides, double-stranded DNA serves as sort of our model system or model system for many people in the field. So these are actually fairly long pieces. So they're about 150 microns in contour length, okay, fully stretched. So that's pretty big. So, you know, the fraction limit is somewhere around 300 nanometers for optical light, visible light. So it's much larger than that. And they're labeled with an intercalating dye, so we can directly see them. So in this, so there's two different movies, and I'm looping them both back and forth. So in this particular case, it starts off, this polymer starts off as a coil, and we turn on a special flow field called an extensional flow field, which has a direction of compression, which is perpendicular this way, and one direction of extension. And the molecule, this is pretty high flow rate, the molecule quickly, you know, wants to stretch out, it's getting kind of pulled back in this outflow direction. And you can even see, you know, that during that stretching process, this chain takes basically a hairpin type configuration or a U-shaped configuration, and that eventually, that hairpin eventually gets pulled out. So we have a direct observation of what the microstructure is and, you know, the molecular motions and sort of, you know, what's going on at this scale during this dynamic process. Okay, and in terms of relaxation, we can then, after it's fully stretched, turn the flow off and watch this relax back to an equilibrium coil. So it's quite a useful technique. So, you know, I guess I've been kind of talking about this a little bit. So we have a direct observation of real-time dynamics. You can also look at molecular subpopulations. So I'm only showing you two examples here, but we oftentimes what we see, if we do this experiment even on the same molecule multiple times, that this one molecule, you know, 10% of the time will do one thing and 90% of the time will do something else in the context of conformation space and dynamics. So we can actually go in and calculate or kind of determine what the distributions of molecular behavior are for a single molecule, and that's pretty useful. And that the idea that a single molecule can undertake different conformations given the same initial conditions is known as this molecular individualism. So it's quite useful, except that, you know, the last, and this has been around for maybe 15, 20 years, but the polymer of choice has really just been double-stranded DNA in the polymer physics or complex fluids community. And so why is that the case? Well, it's kind of just easy to do. So double-stranded DNA is commercially available, so we can purchase these, not this large of a piece, but we basically can purchase monodispersed pieces of something that's bacteriophage, like lambda DNA, for example. The labeling process is straightforward, so there's no, actually, even for these experiments, there's no chemical coupling required. You can just add fluorescent dye to solution. It's an intercalating dye. It gets taken up in a double helix backbone, and then it becomes fluorescent, essentially. And we have some understanding also about the elastic properties, too, so the modeling is pretty straightforward. So, you know, this has been a pretty lucrative enterprise, I would say, for about 20 or so years, starting with the first experiments back in Carlos Bustamante's group and also in Steve Chu's group. And this was complemented or supplemented by the development of this so-called Marco Sagia elastic force extension relation by John Marco, who's at Northwestern, so we can understand sort of what the how to model this in terms of forces and extension. And so, you know, so this was followed by some experiments just in stretching and dilute solution, thinking about more complicated intramolecular effects, and then most recently putting these DNA molecules either under confinement, so in really you know, small nanoscale geometries to think about applications for DNA sequencing and things like that, and also nanoarrays or I guess under nano confinement either way. So, you know, it's been quite lucrative, but in the context of understanding, you know, polymer dynamics and thinking about chemistry and topology, you know, what's the total, I guess, space that exists and what's left to be explored, you know? So how pervasive are these experiments, or how pervasive could they be? And so this is kind of how we envision, at least in my group, the phase space for doing these single polymer experiments. So I'm plotting, you know, on three different axes here. So basically backbone chemistry. So what sort of material in terms of the chemistry are we talking about? Synthetic polymers or something that's more biological. What's the architecture? So what's the topology of these chains? Are they just simply linear things, or could they, or even circular maybe, or more highly branched polymers like comb-shaped polymers? And then as we go kind of on this axis upwards, what's the concentration? So are we talking about ultra-dilute, where it's just a single isolated chain, or is it, you know, in the context of concentrated solutions like spaghetti, where you have, you know, entanglements and really complex, soft condensed matter effects? So the major goal of our research is to basically take this really nice technique and, you know, extend it into more complex materials. And that's what we've been doing recently, and that's what we're going to continue to do for a while, I think. And that's also what the CAS Fellowship has enabled me to do this year. So just to give you a few examples of where we're going in this space, the first, we have extended this technique to look at branch polymers, and then I'll tell you the story about branch polymers in a few slides. And so we've looked at basically dual color cone polymers, so large enough polymer chains that we can actually image using fluorescence microscopy. And so the backbone is one color and the side branches are a second color in red here. So this work, in terms of the synthesis, was based on another technique based on synthesis of structurally defined polymers, which I'll talk about in a second as well. So that's here, and starting off in dilute solution. We're also looking at, through a collaboration, we're looking at dynamics of circular polymers or ring polymers. And so you can kind of see this guy, this movie here, stretching and relaxing. This is a circular polymer, so it's basically, it's almost like a plasmid or a phosmid of double-stranded DNA. Now the interesting thing here, there's no ends, okay? So in terms of reptation or thinking about the dynamics of a concentrated solution of linear chains is completely different when the chain has no ends The entropy and sort of energetic considerations are completely different. We've also synthesized single-stranded DNA to increase the flexibility, so much more flexible than semi-flexible double-stranded DNA because it doesn't have this double helix anymore. And then this story that I'm not going to tell you about today is moving into concentrated solutions. So they were looking at, again, one single polymer here, but it's in the context of an unlabeled concentrated background of entangled solutions that you can't see. And so those entanglements basically change how single polymers are going to stretch and move around. So let's talk about this first example, this first story about branch polymer dynamics. And so the real stars of the show here are Danielle, who's actually sitting in the audience up there right there, and she's embarrassed now, and Amanda, so two graduate students in my group. So Amanda worked on the structurally defined polymers and a synthesis method that allowed us to then move into doing single polymer dynamic studies of these branch polymer chains, and that's what Danielle has been working on. Both of these papers have published very recently, and Danielle's work was so well received that it's on the cover of ACS Macro Letters this month. So the idea is, you know, as kind of I've been saying, is to take these techniques and then move them into the study dynamics of these branched polymer chains, which can have really complex topology. So we need some materials to do this. We need to synthesize something first, some custom synthesis in order to do these experiments. So there's some amount of synthesis here, making the materials, and then there's characterization using single polymer dynamics. So there's two efforts here, and I want to basically motivate how we synthesize these molecules for single polymer dynamics, starting off with Amanda's work. So Amanda was very interested in basically making a batch of branched polymer chains that wherein every single molecule, when she does a synthesis reaction, has the same exact shape. So if she starts off to make a three-arm star batch of polymers, there's, you know, this backbone and every single molecule is the same molecular weight, and this branch has the same molecular weight, and the branch is located at the same exact position. So that's, I would say, fairly impossible or very, very, very difficult to do synthetically using synthetic organic polymer chemistry, but you can do it if you rely on templated synthesis, and I'll explain that in a second, or some hybrid molecule, some biohybrid material that's synthetic or a combination of synthetic and biological applications. So she did that, and she basically made all these different structures, three-arm stars, an H-shape, combs, and black combs. And not only so most of her molecules are based on double-stranded DNA or single-stranded DNA, but they don't have to be. We can graft on side chains of synthetic polymers, and I'll show that in a second. And so then this sort of motivated the scale-up in terms of synthesis reaction, and then synthesizing polymers that are large enough to actually visualize using fluorescence microscopy, so larger than the diffraction limit. Okay, so we have, again, this long linear backbone, and then we have these branches emanating off the side, so it sort of looks like a comb, you know, that you would brush your hair, but I don't have any hair, right? So if you had hair, then you could, you know, brush your hair with it. I'll explain why we're using a dual color method to do this in a second. So let me first talk about some synthesis method for structurally defined polymers, and then I'll go into the single molecule studies. So there's some chemistry here, but I'm not going to go into the details. Basically, it's a two-step synthesis reaction, where in the first step, we're doing a PCR-based reaction, or so-called templated synthesis, based on double-stranded DNA. And that's how we basically get precise placement of chemically reactive and modified, so non-natural bases, along a backbone. And then, so we're positioning these reactive groups, you know, specifically at targeted locations where we want these branches to be. And then in a second step, we can basically link on, in a very high yield or efficiency reaction using copper-free click chemistry, these branch sites, okay? And so by doing this reaction, she can synthesize these different structures. She has very good control over the contour length of the molecular weight of both the branch and the backbone. Excellent control, or perfect control over branch placement. And she can change chemical identity to be biological or not biological. So just one example, this is an H polymer that was made all based on single-stranded DNA. And so we can start running gels and understand, one of the next things to do, I would say, is to understand the migration patterns of these branch polymer chains through gel matrix, and it's quite different than linear polymer chains. So in this particular case, she had basically a red dye just for detection purposes on the branches, and the backbone was stained green, and so the composite is yellow, right? So we get a single band in this particular case for the symmetric H polymer. And then, of course, we had to convince everybody that it was monodisperse and it was well characterized. We had to do some more fancy chemical characterization methods. And so we used denaturing HPLC to do a purification method, and then we followed this by MALDI mass spec to get the molecular weight of this sample. So the calculated is very close to the expected. This is for the symmetric H. She also made an asymmetric H where it wasn't exactly 17 bases either on each side branch or in the cross arm. And in that case, we got the same molecular weight as well. So another cool thing that we can do is to link on a side branch that is not the same as the backbone. So for example, in this particular case, let's say the side branch is something very hydrophobic, like polystyrene, and the backbone itself is something that's very hydrophilic, like single-stranded DNA. And then if you dialyze this into water, into a, basically a solvent that polystyrene really does not like, then you get self-assembly, and we see these particle-like structures form. So block copolymers have been assembled before and to make structures, but the starting material here is exactly well-characterized, and it's sort of a precision molecule in some sense. So one of the future experiments here is to understand the polydispersity and the differences in the chemical structures or the assembled structures that we get, and are they different than starting with a material that's much more sort of messy in some sense. So that's interesting, but those molecules are very small. They're smaller than the diffraction limit, so we're interested in making larger molecules that we can actually image using fluorescence microscopy, and that's where Danielle's work came in. And so she basically used a similar method, except that she's using long-range PCR to get much longer polymerase chain reaction, a much longer sort of backbone here, up to about 30 kilobases. And now we're doing a random, because we don't have that precision control anymore for these larger molecules, we're doing a random incorporation of these non-natural bases. And so at the end of the day, we get a cone polymer with on average, we can control the branch grafting density, but we don't have precision control. We still have precise control over basically the backbone of the branch molecular weights, but we have on average a branch grafting density. But nevertheless, that's really good enough for single molecule fluorescence microscopy. And so she can again characterize these things using just bulk methods by agarose gel electrophoresis, and we see an upshift in the band, denoting the formation of these really big and branched molecules. We go to the microscope, and she's tethering these molecules down to one end on a functionalized surface, and then applying a flow across a cover slip surface, and basically looking one by one, and here's our field of branched or cone polymer molecules. The backbones are labeled green, and the side branches are labeled red. And so we can go in then from one particular stoichiometry in the reaction and basically get a histogram of branch grafting density directly from just looking at molecules. And so for this particular batch, on average, we had about 5 branches per cone, okay? And so we can do that for different chemistries in terms of its synthesis. And then this plot is basically just showing that regardless of how many branches we put on average, the total molecular weight of the backbone stays the same, which it should, right? It should not change. And so we can then change the reaction conditions, and this is just showing that, on average, we have fairly good control over the branch grafting density, but this can all be characterized, and all of this is characterized using direct visualization and single molecule techniques, essentially. So that's characterization. So we can make the materials, they're suitable for single molecule fluorescence, and we can characterize them fairly well, but now we want to look at some dynamics and think about characterizing dynamics, either relaxation or stretching in different conditions. So I will say, I'm not going to go into a full book report on the background of why this is important. Many of the synthetic materials that we use today are comprised of molecules that look just like this, high density, low density polyethylene, things like this. So a major challenge basically is to understand, when you start to change topology, how that's going to affect dynamics and processing under flow conditions. It's a very complex problem when you think about a melt or a concentrated solution of these molecules and how stresses get relieved and things of that nature. So let's start with so we have the molecules, so let's start with a very simple situation. Let's talk about dilute solutions, so just an isolated molecule, and let's start just by thinking about relaxation. So let's stretch it out and watch it relax back to an equilibrium coil. And so I'm going to just give a few slides about how we do those dynamics. So I'm going to talk just a few slides as sort of an aside about microfluidics, and then I'm going to come back to tell you the rest of the story about relaxation of cone polymers. So my lab also, the platform that we use to study dynamics oftentimes is microfluidics, so soft lithography or PDMS-based microfluidic devices. And so we basically just use this as a means to an end in order to study very fine scale motions, single particles or single polymers. And so one thing that we've done recently is to incorporate feedback control into microfluidic devices. And so I'm showing you here a method that we're using, we're calling the microfluidic trap. where it's just an isotropic, so it's just a bead, it's not a polymer chain, but we can confine it in flow. Okay, so this is in free solution, there's other stuff kind of flowing around, and just by basically modulating the flow rates in these four inlets and outlet channels, we can control and trap and micromanipulate the center of mass position of that bead. So we can do the same thing then for polymer chains, and we actually do that. So let me just say one more word about it. So we're talking about, you know, a microfluidic device mounted on the microscope stage. It basically looks like this. We have some connectors for fluid inlets and outlets, and just, you know, taking one of those channels and putting some dye in just to look at what the channels actually look like. This is this cross-slot device, and sometimes we have valving to control flow rates. So one word about the trapping: if we didn't put any control on and we had this cross-slot flow, this is basically what the flow field would look like. Beads would flow in and flow out, sort of looking like these hyperbolic type structures, and there's a zero velocity position or stagnation point in the center. And by controlling the flow rates, we can basically shift around that stagnation point in real time to confine whatever we want at that zero velocity position. That's the idea. And just one sample, trajectory of why this could be really useful for a single polymer chain. So this is a center of mass trapped polymer chain. And so it's, you know, always trapped near its, you know, its center of mass is always trapped near the same XY position in the plane. But in real time, we're basically changing the flow rate, right? So this is the sort of semi-randomly changing the flow rate. And then at the same time, we can map directly or measure exactly what the molecular extension is in response to that variable flow rate. So it's very precise in terms of getting, you know, the exact molecular response as a function of some forcing function in terms of the flow, right? And so we're getting molecular scale information in terms of that forcing function. So that's our sort of bag of tricks for, to some degree, looking at dynamics of single polymer chains. So now let me finish the story and tell you about relaxation of these branch polymer chains. So this is actually, we started off with a surface-based or tethered experiment, okay? So the polymer chains are tethered at one end, and we're again applying flow to stretch these things out. And Danielle did this experiment to look at this relaxation process to measure it as a function of number of branching and basically the general topology of these molecules. So let's start with something that's really long, about a 30 kilobase backbone, and the average or the branch size is about 10 kilobases. And what she noticed is that basically at time zero, this thing is pretty stretched. You turn the flow off, so there's no more force trying to make it stretch. You get this initial quick elastic response. And then you sort of have this intermediate stage where, because the molecular weight of these two are about the same, there's mixing. So there's basically mixing of modes between the relaxation of the backbone and also the branches. But the branches are shorter, so eventually they relax and they're sort of done, you know, kind of, they're no longer stretched and they're done relaxing. And then at very long times, the backbone kind of relaxes the rest of the way. And so we can go in and basically analyze that more quantitatively by fitting, as a first initial guess, single exponential decaying functions to basically that relaxation process. So this is just a plot of the fractional extension or the total stretched extension of that backbone as a function of time, and then as a function of the topology, right? So this is an average, these curves are an average over many molecules that had the same topology, basically, the same number of branches. And as you increase the number of branches, then over these really long time scales, the backbone itself is slower to relax. There's more friction involved, and it you know, fairly substantially slows down the relaxation time of the backbone. Only one branch, however, is pretty similar to the linear chain. But this is the first, as far as we know, sort of direct observation of topology-dependent relaxation of polymer chains. And this is kind of more in the same. This is my second to last slide. We can also not only look at the longest relaxation time here, but we can also look at intermediate time scales. And so there's a little bit more mixing here between branch dynamics and backbone dynamics, but here actually we see an even bigger impact of branching. So having three branches, more branches in terms of this backbone actually slows it down significantly compared to linear or molecules with a single branch. So this intermediate time scale is actually affected even more. And so I think I'm gonna conclude there in the interest of time. So basically, these experiments are the first to extend single polymer studies to polymers with complex topologies, combs, stars, et cetera. We saw that, as I got to the end of the story, branch grafting density has a strong effect on relaxation processes. And moving forward, we're gonna take these molecules and put them into more concentrated solutions to understand how branching actually affects stretching in the context of other molecules being around this one particular polymer chain. And we're also working with a colleague in chemical engineering, Charles Singh, to develop a theory for cone polymer dynamics, at least in dilute solution. And so I'll end there with acknowledgments, and thank you very much. I had basically an entire second story on that, but I just didn't, in the interest of time, I didn't show it. So this is just, we have more quantitative data, if you'd like. So first of all, this is in semi-dilute solution, so it's not fully concentrated. So the chains are overlapping each other at equilibrium, but it's not fully entangled, though. Not fully entangled. So it's not like a melt, but it's approaching a melt. What we see, I guess, is, first of all, qualitatively, when we stretch these molecules out in the context of the background unlabeled here, we see a difference in the conformation space. So we see different conformations being undertaken by these molecules during stretching. And so we see, in some cases, uniform stretching. In a lot of cases, we see what we call hooks, but either hindered or facilitated, and we think that, you know, these chains might be hooked on to another invisible chain back there that's either helping it, or that's, you know, depending on where the hook is, it either makes it stretch faster or not. And then we're sort of quantifying all this. You know, this is just one sample, but as a function of flow rate, we've done a series of these step strain experiments where we apply flow for a certain amount of time or a certain amount of strain and then turn it off. And then we can plot directly the, you know, I guess the transient behavior as a function of conformation and get different sort of distributions in terms of histograms, in terms of conformation space.
Can you put them into a rheometer too?
We could, yeah. I mean, so one issue that we face in all the synthesis that I talked about in the first part of the talk is scaling up the synthesis to get enough material to make bulk scale measurements on. So for this material, yes, we can make enough of it for, you know, one milliliter or something to make a measurement. For the branched polymer chains, not quite yet. Tough to make that much, I think. Yeah.
As a follow-up to this, do you also get actually knotted? can you detect those? I know that other people have seen.
So yeah, with knotting, so with double-stranded DNA of these molecular weights, we basically never see knotting unless you force
except
a knot.
Way you detect them, or because they're not there?
So double-stranded DNA is actually pretty, it's semi-flexible, and so it's pretty inflexible. And so I think the probability for knot formation decreases significantly when the back, because of the double helix, it's very rigid. So if you go to single-stranded DNA, or you go to something like polystyrene or carbon-carbon backbone, then yes, naturally you're going to get knots. And so with single-stranded DNA, we do see that. And then interestingly, I don't have it here, but with the circular polymers, we see knotting at equivalent molecular weights for the linear, and I don't really understand that at the moment. So, yeah.
More questions? Yeah, last question.
Have you looked at these as lubricants with, you know, sort of like friction, reducing friction with different concentrations?
Yeah, we've thought about doing some experiments where we make polymer brushes on a surface. So we can polymerize off the surface to get a brush. That's probably, I think that's the best way to get a higher surface coverage. So we can do that, we have not done that. Yeah, we could.
Okay, thank you very
thank you.
Much.
Professor Brunner got his BS at Purdue, and then he got his PhD at Johns Hopkins, and did a postdoc in Caltech, and has been here for 12 years or so?
Something like that.
Okay, he's been associated, actually, I knew him at NCSA and Beckman, and so anyway, he's going to talk today about statistical and machine learning for petascale astronomy. I guess you're also one of the big data people on campus, right?
Yeah. Should we wear a big D on
yeah,
the shirt
that's right.
to identify ourselves? So first, it's a great privilege to be able here to be here and to be able to talk, and an even greater privilege to have had the Center for Advanced Study appointment. It really came at a crucial time because the data sets that I'm going to be talking about, in particular, one of them is just starting to get data, and so we're really trying to strive to jump on board. And a lot of the work I'm going to be talking about, as is generally the case with faculty, is the work of some graduate students. Matthias actually has finished up and is now working at NCSA, and Edward is well into his project. So I wanted to take a minute to remind everyone a little bit about where I'm coming from. I come from an astronomy and astrophysics background, and of course, astronomers get to show lots of pretty pictures. One of the benefits of astronomy in general is that it is a gateway science, right? It helps bring many people into STEM fields. They may be interested in things, but it's also very different, right? So we just had a wonderful talk about work that's being done in a lab, right? Well, we're living in our lab. We can't actually go and change the conditions. We have to observe and see what's there and make our inferences from that. And another point is that it's a very big universe that we live in, right? Professor Cho Wendy here was actually saying that they're bigger than astronomy, right? Bigger than the age of the universe. Well, I'd say you're still living in the universe, so we still have that. But no, it is a big, and because of that, it's going to be big data, no matter what we do. We start observing, and even the limited capabilities that we currently have, we're limited in the amount of information that we're getting. And the other important thing is if something's very rare, we need to keep observing over and over and over again. So this is going to be a theme, and Ed Seidel, director of NCSA, mentioned a little bit some of these new trends coming in astronomy, and I think that'll be the case in many fields, where we're sort of having this convergence of different ways of doing the same science and bringing more and more data to bear. But the challenge that I'm really looking at is a little bit differently. I've actually moved a little more away from astronomy, a little more into this growing realm of data science, and that's the simple thing that we have so much data, it's not clear how do we get the information that we really need out of that data, right? And it may seem a bit odd. You have so much data, why do you have to spend so much time being very careful about trying to pull stuff out? And I'll try to detail a little bit about why that's the case. But first, a little bit, why astronomy? Right? Why would anyone doing data science and computer science be interested in astronomy, right? I mean, there's many fascinating questions. I mean, this voter redistricting, I totally agree, that was really interesting. This is Jim Gray. He passed away a few years ago mysteriously, but he used to work with different groups, and he actually started working with astronomers quite actively around 2000. And he was head of Microsoft Research. His then boss, Bill Gates, would say to him, and Jim would tell us these stories all the time. He worked with me, and he loved to say the story. Bill came to him, Jim, why are you working with astronomers? Right? We make money selling operating systems. And Jim had a great reply that because their data is worthless, right? And it seems sort of odd as a scientist to be standing up here saying, yeah, you should listen to me. What I do, it's worthless. The point, though, isn't that the science or the knowledge is worthless. It's that the data is worthless. So you can do whatever you want with it. And that's what he liked to partner with us. There weren't any HRPA or HIPAA or FIPA or whatever regulations that would be tied to your data. You know, you could do what you wanted with it, right? And there also was a lot of public appeal because of the beauty of the astronomy images, the sort of fundamental questions about our species has been asking for thousands and thousands of years. And that sort of led into lots of new investigations. So I hesitated showing this picture because of the time of day, right? You've been sitting here listening to things, but this is a banana chocolate chip streusel cake, right? It looks really delicious. But I'm showing this for a very specific reason, and that is, if you wanted to know what this was made of and all you had were pictures, how would you go about doing it? That's what we have to deal with in astronomy, right? We live in our universe. As much as we might fantasize as kids about getting in a spaceship and traveling throughout the universe, we can't. There's fundamental laws of physics that prevent that, right? We are limited in our ability to explore our solar system, let alone go to the nearest star, let alone go to the far reaches of our galaxy or even the far reaches of our universe. So we have to sit here and observe and make inferences about what we see and what that tells us about what the universe is made of. So that's what we do, right? We look around. And here are various things, right? So there's me, there's the NCSA building, there's the state of Illinois, right, with nice voting districts outlined. There's the Earth, there's the Sun, right? There's the Earth really small, there's a nearby galaxy, M51, the Whirlpool galaxy, here's clusters of galaxies. Everything we see is made of what's called normal baryonic matter, protons and neutrons and electrons, right? And when we think about all of that and we go out, and it's a lot, right? I mean, we like to think of ourselves as important. When we look at that, all right, if you think about the entire slide as 100%, that's all normal matter, right? And we get this by just going out and observing conditions, right? So you say, well, what is that? Well, about 5% of the universe is this normal matter, all right? So even ourselves, we're small in the cosmos. Most of the stuff is not anything like us. So what is it? Well, part of it, about 26% of the universe is made of this mysterious thing called dark matter. And that's very interesting because we don't know much about it other than its matter. And we know it's matter because it interacts gravitationally, okay? It might interact via the weak electromagnetic force, but if so, it's extremely, extremely weak. So it doesn't emit light, doesn't absorb light, right? It's very hard to see because of that, hence dark, but it's gravitationally interacting, so it's matter. And we'd like to know a lot more about that. And part of the reason is because this leads to direct questions about the standard model of particle physics. Right, so CERN is built to try to understand that better, and that's one of the things that we're trying to understand as well. What is this dark matter? How does it control the universe? But that leaves a lot more, right? 69% or so of the universe is this other mysterious thing called dark energy, right? It's not matter. It doesn't interact via gravity the same way matter interacts. It also doesn't emit or absorb light, so it's dark. And this is interesting because it's possible that it leads to a modification of one of our greatest scientific theories, general relativity. Or alternatively, it's a totally unknown state of matter or energy that we just don't quite understand how it interacts with other things. So there's a lot of very interesting things that can come about, right? And this is simply from observing and seeing what's out there. So how do we go about this? Well, I actually should take a minute because sometimes students tell me, hey, wait a minute, I can go into my nearest Walgreens and find dark energy and dark matter on the shelf. It's not quite the same thing, not FDA approved either. So let me just remind you, right, here's a picture. This is a nearby cluster of galaxies. In this image, there are tens of thousands of galaxies, even more that are really faint. But this sort of re-emphasizes the point that we're trying to do. We want to come in here and from this picture, identify things as galaxies, right? And other things we want to identify as stars. Because if I'm interested in the entire cosmos, I need to remove the stars, which are in our galaxy, to study the whole universe. Conversely, if I simply want to know what is my galaxy I'm living in shaped like, I have to just have the stars. So the very first step is a classification, right? And there's lots of sources. That's one of the problems. The other thing is, all right, that's easy. Okay, that's a galaxy. When I start getting to these little dots, they get much harder to tell, right? And so historically, we've had some algorithms to sort of do this, but they're generally what we call morphological. And they don't use the full information. So we're trying to move into this more probabilistic realm where we can use the full information available to tell whether something is a star or a galaxy. And even more than that, what type of galaxy and what type of star. Because that gives us a better handle on all the information that's available. So the other thing to keep in mind is this sky is big, right? So there's the full moon right there. The data from one of these surveys that I've been involved in, the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, which has been completed, covered about a third of the entire sky. Right, and there is a lot of data here. So the Virgo cluster was about the size of the full moon, maybe a little bit bigger. So you think about it as one of these tiny little dots. This is an image just made from the data. You just plot it and you put it onto a sort of projection, a dome-like projection, and you can get an image. A lot of data. Now, one last thing I want to do before I start talking a little bit more about what I did for my Center for Advanced Study appointment is, when you know we see data, right? I'm showing you pictures, but in reality, an object emits across the spectrum, right? A star emits a energy across a range of wavelengths, and that contains information about the physics and the chemistry of those objects. And so, if we have spectra, it's great. The problem is, it's very hard to get spectra. You need really big telescopes to gather lots of light from these very faint objects. So what we do is we observe them through a narrow wavelength and take a picture. Okay, and we do that across a couple of different what we call filters and get pictures in different wavelengths, and then we try to use that to reconstruct this underlying spectrum. All right, and so I just wanted to sort of use that before we jump into the more relevant part of my talk. So here, we have across the top, I thought about doing this as a quiz, right? And you don't get to leave for lunch until you've actually successfully answered it, but I'll spare you that. So here across the top, we have stars, and in this row, we have galaxies. And if you look on the left, you can probably, non-experts, look at this and say, yeah, okay, these are galaxies, and you get over here, it gets a little harder to tell, right? So the first thing is, right, we want to pull out the stars, and we want to say what type of star. Is it a star like our sun? Is it a much hotter, bigger star? Is it a much colder star? That can be useful for understanding our galaxy, or if you want to just say, where should I look if I want to find exoplanets that might host life? Right? There's very valid reasons for wanting to be able to do not just star galaxy, but subtypes. The other interesting thing is that as we go from one column to the next, it's near exponential growth in the numbers. So while it's easy to see, oh, star galaxy over here, the majority of the sources are over here, and that's where it gets really difficult. Okay? And the number of sources we have to do this now are in the hundreds of millions range. We're going to be soon up into the tens of billions range. That's with the LSST. And this just makes it much more difficult when we try to build models of what the universe is and where the matter is and how it's distributed. So that sort of shows a little bit of the problem. The other thing I want to make a point of, this is only one part of the problem, only one thing that I was working on in my CAS, and that's the simplest one I'm showing you, is star or galaxy or even subtypes. We also need to know how far away are these galaxies that we're looking at, right? Because if we're trying to understand the evolutionary history of our universe, that's what we also need. We need to know how far away these things are and how they've had time to grow under gravitational collapse. And then thirdly, when we have both, whether it's a star or galaxy, how far away it is, we need to know how to use that probabilistic information to infer what is the right cosmology, right? How much dark matter is there? Is it changing at all in cosmic time? How much dark energy is there? Is it changing at all? These are fundamental questions that we would like to know, and so we have to look at this new way of dealing with the data and using the data then to understand the scientific question that we're after. So here I just have a quick plot showing how we actually currently, or before I started my CAS appointment, did this morphological classification. So here's a star, here's a galaxy, and the fundamental point is stars are very small and concentrated, so most of the light is in a very tiny little, what we call aperture, right? And then if you draw a bigger aperture around it, you can see that there's not as much light. So it's very concentrated. So stars form this part of the distribution here, and galaxies, on the other hand, tend to be more spread out, and so galaxies are this part of the distribution. And so this is technically a mixed distribution, right? We have two populations and they're mixed, and we want to try to disentangle that. And this is the way we used to do it. The problem is, as you get down here, where most of the sources are, they start to become mixed and it becomes very hard to disentangle them. Now, this leads into the current data that we're using. This is the Dark Energy Survey. This is a survey I helped start about 10 years ago. And this is the field of view of the camera. So if you think about your cell phone camera might do part of one of these. These are 2K by 4K CCDs. There's roughly 70 of these in here. And you take a picture, you get 70 of these giant images. It's taken down in Chile. The data is shipped up here to NCSA where it's processed and archived. So we have the data here. And this is a great project. And it's entered the Petascale, and we now have this challenge of all of these data, all of these CCDs taking pictures and trying to understand what is it seeing and how do we use that information to understand our universe. So fundamentally what we're doing is we're taking lots of data, and I've just shown a subset here, right? There's could be many, many, many more columns. You could have very large feature vectors. Here we're only showing about 7 dimensions, but you could have hundreds of dimensions. And then the number of sources is where we get up into the range of a billion. So it is a big learning challenge, and we do use supercomputers, we use XSEED, we've used Blue Waters in the past, but this is the fundamental task that we're going forward. And this is something that I see more and more across our campus when you talk to people, and that's been one of the fun things about having this Center for Advanced Study appointment, meeting people in other domains, you know, whether they have a billion records or whether they have 100 records, but tens of thousands of feature vectors, or whatever the issue is, this is a common thread that we're starting to see across this campus and across our world and our academic research disciplines, that data is becoming more and more prevalent in a range of disciplines. So thinking about not only how do we do it in our discipline, but how do we do it in different disciplines, how do we tie that stuff together such that we have a coherent educational curriculum and a coherent plan to attack these. We heard this morning from the interdisciplinary centers, there is work there. I think it's quite an exciting time, and I hope to continue these conversations. So now I want to talk briefly a little bit about some of the ways we do the classification. So what my idea was that I pitched for the Center for Advanced Study appointment, the fundamental one was that we wanted to use different techniques and combine them together. So the first one we use is a standard technique. It's become standard now. A few years ago it wasn't, but it's called a random forest. And the idea is really simple. It's built on a decision tree. And a decision tree is easy to understand. You get up in the morning and you say, what am I going to wear? Right? Well, first thing you want to know is how warm is it going to be, right? It's really important this time of year here in East Central Illinois. Is it raining, right? So you're going to ask questions like this. So here's a little decision tree that's shown up here, right? You basically build decisions and you branch out in different ways. And you build that from your data, and then the next day you can come in and say, well, yesterday I wore this and I was perfectly fine, and today looks the same way, I'll wear the same thing, or you'll make a different decision based on the data you have. That's one decision tree. A random forest, and this is an actual picture of one we built, does it a little bit differently. It takes lots of decision trees, and it uses something that actually kind of comes from voting theory, where if you have lots of weak learners or weakly informed people, that they can actually make a better decision than experts. And it's sort of the collective of the power of many. There's a story that if you want to know how to guess the number of jelly beans in a jar, you ask 100 people and you take the average, and that's almost always right. Or at least very, very close. And that's the same idea here, okay? So you basically build each decision tree and you use a limited subset of the data. So you don't use all of the data and you don't use all of the attributes for each data and you change it randomly each time. That's the random part of this forest. And the forest is that you have many, many, many trees. So you build these up and then you apply them to your data and you get your predictions, right? This is an example of a supervised learning because we're using the data to train the model, okay? So that's one technique. And random forest is standard. It's now in just about any package you're going to use for data mining. We actually developed our own because we were using it on very large data sets, typical applications that you might use either in Python, R, some other, excuse me, other languages. They don't scale well to very large data sets. Next thing is I want to talk about an unsupervised learning method that we've been using. It's based on something called a self-organizing map. And this concept may be a little hard to understand, but you effectively use a neural network to take a high-dimensional space and deproject it, or I'm sorry, project it down to a two-dimensional surface in a topologically conserving manner. Now, basically, that's just fancy words for something that's pretty easy to understand. So here's part of a campus map, right? Now, everybody that's going to be coming to campus has different backgrounds. They may be different genders, different ethnicities, different backgrounds. They went to a different undergrad. They went to a different grad school. They had different ages. But when you look at the map, you can see that, hey, you know, let's see here. Where's Green Street? Astronomy building is like right here, okay? So if you want to know where the astronomers are or people interested in astronomy, that's probably a good place to go, right? Even though there's some doing it in physics, some doing it in NCSA, some doing it in chemistry, you still know that, right? And conversely, if you want to know where the chemistry, right, you can come down here by chemistry, molecular cellular biology, you can go to those places and you're going to know it. And so what that's done is effectively taken people with different backgrounds, different, you know, histories, and put them in the same place. That's the idea of this self-organizing map, okay? So what we do is we take the data set, we generate this two-dimensional surface. We actually are using the surface of a sphere because it has no boundary conditions then, so this wraps around to this side. And then you basically get data points lying in the same part of this space that are similar. And you can use that fact to then say, well, what are these objects? Are these stars or are these galaxies or are these people that are going to vote Republican or are these people going to vote Democrat or whatever? And you can then use that data to say, well, this is what my algorithm found. So this is unsupervised, that it builds the model without knowing anything about your final label. And then what we did is we took it and built something that we created. It's called a random atlas, where we use the map, these self-organizing maps like trees when you do a random forest. So you build lots of these maps, you randomize things, and you get all kinds of stuff out. So that was the second technique we did. We then developed a hierarchical Bayesian technique. Bayesian techniques, you simply need to have models. So these are our models of what galaxies might look like. We then generate fake observations, and we match them to the real observations. And we can develop Bayesian technique for that. Either that satisfied you or it won't, and it won't matter how much longer I spend on it, so I'll move on. For anyone who knows Bayesian techniques. Then we come to the real fun thing, and that is how do we combine these different techniques? And this is another new thing that we've developed with the Center for Advanced Study Fellowship. And that is we can look at the different areas of parameter space that our observations occupy. And this is, again, we like self-organizing maps, so we actually applied those to our data set to say, rather than just saying, in general, how do we say something's a star or galaxy, we say, let's take our big data set, chop it up into smaller data sets where hopefully things are similar to each other in each cell. And then we have this cell here maps to this cell here, maps to this cell here. And we basically have weights for how important were the different techniques in combining the data together. Okay, and this is interesting because this is now really bright objects. So this is where the current technique worked well. This is now faint objects. This is where it's really hard to say whether something's a galaxy or a star. And interestingly enough, we had that this technique, this is unsupervised, has higher weights down here where it's harder to classify, kind of like we would hope. And the technique, this TPZ, is a supervised technique. It works really well up here where the data is really, really good. And so it sort of showed us what we would expect. And so we've developed this other technique called a Bayesian model combination that we then apply on top of these in sort of a meta-classification framework to sort of give us an even better prediction. And this was just some standard plots to show how well we actually are doing. This is something called an ROC curve, and a perfect ROC curve goes all the way over and then drops down. And so we're getting better and better with our techniques. And that's good. And then this sort of shows how we're doing a better job of matching what the DES survey requires in order to meet their funding objectives. So that's important. So take a step back again, right? This is the problem we're after. Whenever we're going to use supervised techniques, we actually have to know whether something's a star or a galaxy. So how do we get that, right? We don't force our graduate students to spend the first year staring at images and saying star, galaxy, right? We thought about it. There were issues. We moved on. It's not going to happen. Yeah. So what do we do? Well, it turns out that this is actually a great citizen science project. Again, going back to astronomy as a gateway science, there actually was a project developed from the Sloan survey that I was previously involved with, and they actually would put images up and have people look at them. And it turned out that people love this, right? So Ed mentioned that student, that 10-year-old girl that found the supernova. This was the project, how she could go through and look at it, and her son. And there were her brother. All kinds of interesting things that came out of this. And this is really important. This is now, you know, known as citizen science. And this is interesting. And so this is actually a project I sort of started with in Beckman with Tom Huang and his group, and looking how can we use information theory to say, look, people just looking at stars or galaxies, they haven't been trained. Do they really know what they're doing? You can actually apply information theory to say, how well are they actually doing? And then use that to improve the reliability of your training, because you're saying it's not 100% known to be a star or galaxy. Your training data themselves can have issues. And so that's something that's also interesting going forward. Now, you know, just to say we're not sitting on our laurels, DES is going on right now, right? It's sort of a precursor experiment for this. This is a fascinating experiment. It's effectively going to create movies of the universe, right? So this is really new for us, being able to see how the sky is changing. And what that means, because now we actually have more data, we've looked at things multiple times, and we could use that to say whether it's a star or galaxy even better, or what type of galaxy. I think these numbers are actually a little out of date. It's going to start in about 5 or 6 years, and again, Illinois and CSA are the data management. This is something I actually brought here about 10 years ago now. It's been going on a long time. SKA is another project that's on the horizon. It's a radio survey. Its data rates are ridiculous. So you know, these challenges are only going to get more and more important, and this is just in astronomy. Every science is facing these, right? There's more and more data, and it becomes easier and easier to get it, and it's harder to get stuff out of that, actually to make sense of your data. And you know, one thing I want to try to say is, I'm sitting here saying star or galaxy. In truth, we don't. We say star or galaxy with some probability, and we don't even necessarily know how to use that probability in our measurements. Right, because you fundamentally changed the game when you said it's not just a star or a galaxy. We think it's this with this likelihood, right? And so now we're talking about billions of these things, and how do you actually use that? It complicates your algorithms, it complicates your analysis, but it enables us to have more precision on answering the very things we're after, which is, what is dark matter? What is dark energy? Are they evolving in time, or are they constant? And these are things that we have to know. And so this whole idea I was just mentioning, right, LSST effectively does 2 Sloan surveys a week, right? That big image I showed you at the start that was covering this guy, that was a Sloan, right? And LSST is going to do like 2 of those a week, right? And it's going to run for 10 years. So fundamentally changing the data rate. You'll be able to see things that change dramatically. You'll see things that pop up into existence and disappear. And these are esoteric things, you know, whether they're stars that just flare, whether they're stars that explode, you know, whatever. Important stuff. There are precursor experiments we're looking at. You know, we feel they're a little small. There are only 500 million objects, and they've each only got 200 to 500 million observations each. I mean, but still, interesting stuff. And the other interesting thing is that these are challenging because these are odd data sets to study, and that, you know, you have non-Gaussian errors, you have heteroscedastic errors, you've got strange sampling rates. And so this is also something that I've been talking with people in statistics trying to get a better handle on. Are there existing techniques that we can apply to these? How can we use this information to improve our classification accuracy, or our ability to estimate how far away these things are? There's a lot of science there that we're trying to pursue. So that I'll summarize real quickly. I want to emphasize that while we have what might be considered big data, it's really more of big challenges. And it's the key challenge is learning from the data, getting useful and important things from the data. And so for that, you have to understand the data. You can't just start applying randomly some algorithms. You have to understand what are your limitations. You have to be willing to try new approaches. And I think this leaves us with many wonderful educational opportunities. Right? We can't do this work. I just said most of this work was done by graduate students. I think that's kind of a common thing here. We've got to make sure they're trained right in order to be doing this stuff, and maybe be talking with different people on campus than we might have otherwise done, which has been a wonderful thing about this Center for Advanced Study appointment. And lastly, I just want to harp, anyone want to talk about data science? I'd love to do so. Thank you.
But my father was an astronomer, and he was working in the 80s on models of galaxy with mathematicians who were working on the Cray computer and doing pi out to whatever to kind of show it off. It's sort of a worthless data thing, and so he had one of these things. And I'm sure, you know, he's not even in the realm of one of those precursor that you look at this point, you know, from 30 years hence, and it makes me wonder then going forward, and looking back, you know, a generation at what you're doing right now, like what is the half-life for what you find, and how can you see it informing people later?
So if I might sort of try to paraphrase what you're asking, right, that you make discoveries of things, and is that going to be carried forward? Let me address that in two ways. One, when we've said something's a star or galaxy with probability or whatever, right, that's going to be there. That's in the archive. People can use that later. And they may come along and say, you guys were crazy, right? What you did was completely wrong. You know, one of the things that I've explored a little more with this Center for Advanced Study appointment is something called deep learning, where you actually go straight into the images, right? Everything I've talked to you about was done on catalogs that have been generated by these surveys, right? They analyze their images and they make a catalog and say, oh, here's where the things were, here's their feature vectors, you know, and we can come along and classify them. But there's these new algorithms called deep learning that come in, and I sort of got inspiration because once I was, you know, at a son's band concert, and I took my phone up and I was trying to take a picture, and I suddenly realized it just put little squares around everybody's faces from like 100 feet away. Why can it do that, and yet we can't classify stars and galaxies on our images, right? So I started talking with people here on campus that do that, and that may totally change what we do all over again, right? So that's sure, we are going to continually evolve and change, and I think if anything, and that's the beauty of a statistical approach, is you build on prior knowledge, right? So you have your prior knowledge, your prior data, you keep that and you advance farther. Second thing is, you were talking explicitly about simulations, doing simulations to understand stuff. One of the key points that I would like to make is, and Ed made this point earlier, was that we are starting to see the synergy between simulations and observations or experimental data, and having either observations drive the simulations in a certain way, or the simulations drive observations in a new way. And this is only going to become more and more important. There's the standard way in astronomy we gather data is via the electromagnetic spectrum, right? We get light and we see and we infer physically what that tells us. But there's new things that are coming on, either neutrino astronomy or gravitational wave astronomy, where you try to see the effects from different fundamental forces in nature and what that tells us about the cosmos. And so those will require synergies between these standard ways of doing things, new ways of doing things, and then using simulations to help guide what you think you actually should do with your next experiment. So you're actually seeing more of this synergy. And sort of lastly, the point is we tend not to forget, you know, people that have done, you know, groundbreaking work, you know, whenever it was. So somebody doing groundbreaking work in the simulations, yeah, the number of particles will have changed and the resolution, the accuracy, but, you know, those fundamental early techniques still are referenced and used.
Thank you.
Any other questions? You can still read Galileo, right? It's still right.
Galileo, the Galilean moons, we still call them that, yeah. And we're looking for life there now, right? So. So the fundamental question, I guess I would say, is or address what you asked me, how do we know that when we're looking at stars and the other part of our side of our galaxy will be like our stars, or other galaxies will be similar to ours? And fundamentally, it's just down to fundamental physics, right? That we know enough about our sun, and we know that it's thermonuclear fusion that drives our sun, and we know about diffusion processes to understand how photons propagate out, and we understand electromagnetic theory well enough to understand how those photons propagate through space, that we wouldn't expect massive changes in that. But there used to be some real concern about this, right? So for instance, everything could be antimatter, and it would look just the same, unless some matter came into contact with it, right? So there have been searches for that, and they've been null results. But by and large, it's basically based on our understanding of fundamental physics. We don't see why that wouldn't be the case. However, as physicists, you always leave yourself open to new and interesting ways for science to inform you that you're wrong, and that would be fantastic, right? But we already have 95% of the universe that we don't know what it is, so there are some remaining unanswered questions.
Okay, well, thank you.